Then the legislative powers in India. Legislative powers in India has three dimensions. First, scope of legislative powers in India. Composition. Article 79 provides that there shall be a parliament for the union, which shall consist of the president and two houses to be known as respectively as the Council of the States and the House of the People. In the same manner, Article 168 provides for constitution of legislature in states. For every state, there shall be a legislature which shall consist of the governor, and in the states of Bihar, Maharashtra, Karnataka and Uttar Pradesh, two houses, and in other state, one house. Where there are two houses of the legislature of a state, one shall be known as the Legislative Council and the other as the Legislative Assembly. And where there is only one house, it shall be known as the Legislative Assembly. Functions under Article 245 and 246. Parliament has exclusive power to legislate on matters enumerated in List 1, that is Union List. Article 248 states that Parliament has exclusive power to make any law with respect to any matter not enumerated in the concurrent list or the state list. In the same manner, the legislature of the state has exclusive power to legislate on matters enumerated in List 2, that is state list. Both Parliament as well as state legislature can legislate on matters enumerated in List 3, that is concurrent list. Framing rules of procedure. Each House of Parliament may make rules for regulating its procedure and the conduct of its business subject to the provisions of the Constitution, and in the same manner, the legislature of a state may make rules for regulating its procedure and the conduct of its business subject to the provisions of the Constitution. The second aspect of legislative powers in India is the interference of legislature in executive. Then, first, role in election of president. Article 54 provides that the president shall be elected by the members of an electoral college consisting of the elected members of both houses of parliament and the elected members of the legislative assemblies of the state. Impeachment proceedings against president carried on by the parliament. An impeachment is a quasi-judicial procedure in parliament. Either house may prefer the charge of violation of the constitution before the other house, which shall then either investigate the charge itself or cause the charge to be investigated. But the charge cannot be preferred by a house unless a resolution containing the proposal is moved after a 14 days notice in writing, signed by not less than 1/4 of the total number of members of that house, and the resolution is then passed by a majority of not less than 2/3 of the total membership of the house. Council of Ministers to aid and advise President. Article 74 clause 1 provides that there shall be a Council of Ministers with the Prime Minister at the head to aid and advise the President, who shall in exercise of his function act in accordance with such advice. In the similar provision of Council of Ministers to aid and advise the Governor has been made under Article 163. The third aspect of legislative powers in India is relating to interference of legislature in judiciary. Firstly, courts should not to inquire into proceedings of Parliament or legislature. Article 122 provides that the court shall not call validity of any proceedings in Parliament in question on the ground of any alleged irregularity of procedure. Similarly, Article 212 provides that the court should not inquire into the proceedings of the legislature. Then, parliamentary privileges under Article 105 and 194. Privileges are those rights without which it would be impossible for either house to maintain its independence of action or the dignity of its position. They may be divided into two groups. Firstly, those which are enjoyed by the members individually, and secondly, those belonging to each house of the parliament as a collective body. The privilege of the house collectively are, first, the right to publish debates and proceedings and the right to restrain publication by others. Secondly, the right to exclude others. Third, right to regulate the internal affairs of the House. Fourthly, the right to publish parliamentary proceedings. Fifth, right to punish members and outsiders for breach of its privileges. In P.V. Narasimha Rao versus State, it was observed that it is not enough that members should be protected against civil action and criminal proceedings, the cause of action of which is their speech or vote. To enable the members to participate fearlessly in parliamentary debates, members need the wider protection of immunity against all civil and criminal proceedings that bear a nexus to their speech or vote. But the trend has been changed. In Raja Rampal versus Honorable Speaker Lok Sabha, the court held that even if Parliament had only the limited remedial power to punish for contempt, the power to expel would be well within the limits of such remedial contempt power. In Manohar Lal Sharma versus Principal Secretary, the Supreme Court held that for successful working of democracy, it is essential that public revenue are not defrauded and public servants do not indulge in bribery and corruption, and if they do, such allegations should be inquired into fairly, properly and promptly, and those who are guilty are brought to book. Then thirdly, adjudication of water disputes. Article 262 provides that Parliament may by law provide for the adjudication of any dispute to the use, distribution or control of the waters of or in any interstate river or river valley, and notwithstanding anything in this constitution, Parliament may by law provide that neither the Supreme Court nor any other court shall exercise jurisdiction in respect of any such dispute or complaints. The Supreme Court refused to interfere in the policy adopted by the state for allocation of water from Sardar Sarovar project to the district of Kutch. It can interfere only if policy is inconsistent with the constitutional laws or arbitrary or irrational, and it was held in Kutch Jal Sankat Nivaran Samiti versus State of Gujarat. Then, fourthly, role of legislature in removal of judges. A judge of the Supreme Court may be removed by an order of the President on ground of proved misbehavior or incapacity. The order of the President can only be passed after he has been addressed to by both houses by a majority of total membership of that house and also by a majority of not less than 2/3 of a members present and voting. Then, separation of powers in India and third organs, that is judicial powers in India. Judicial powers in India has to be studied from three dimensions. The first is scope of judicial powers in India. Article 13 makes fundamental rights enforceable in the courts. It declares that a law which is inconsistent with the fundamental rights is void, whether that law is pre-constitutional or post-constitutional. This power of judicial review is exercised by the Supreme Court and the High Court under Article 32 and 226 respectively. The courts can declare a law unconstitutional if it is inconsistent with the fundamental rights. The second aspect is interference of judiciary in executive. First, interference of judiciary in executive powers relating to clemency powers, Article 72 and 161. In Devender Pal Singh Bhullar versus State of NCT of Delhi and Shatrughan Chauhan versus Union of India, the Supreme Court held that the power vested in the President under Article 72 and the Governor under Article 161 of the Constitution is manifestation of the prerogative of the state. It is neither a matter of grace nor a matter of privilege, but is an important constitutional responsibility to be discharged by the highest executive, keeping in view the consideration of larger public interest and welfare of people. The said power has to be exercised with the aid of justice and not in defiance of it. Though no words of limitation are indicated in these articles, but the said power is subject to limited judicial review on the ground of unfair, unjust and unreasonable procedure of disposal of mercy petition. Secondly, interference in ordinance making power of the executive. In A.K. Roy versus Union of India, the Supreme Court held that the ordinance making power of the president would be subject to the tests of vagueness, arbitrariness, reasonableness, public interest, and that it was passed during the recess of the Union Parliament. In D.C. Wadhwa versus State of Bihar, it was brought to the notice of the court that between 1967 and 1980 in the State of Bihar, 256 ordinances were promulgated, and all these were kept alive for periods ranging from 1 year to 14 years by promulgation, re-promulgation from time to time. The Supreme Court struck down this exercise of the ordinance-making power as a subversion of the democratic process and culpable exercise of power. The court held that such exercise of power amounted to a fraud upon the Constitution and hence unconstitutional. The court observed that the executive could not usurp the functions assigned to the legislature under the Constitution. Then, last aspect is the interference of judiciary in legislature. Power to regulate its proceedings under Article 145 and 227 Clause 2 Clause B. The Supreme Court can make rules for the regulating generally the practice and procedure of the court, including rules as to the persons practicing before the court, rules as to the procedure for hearing appeals and other matters pertaining to appeals, including the time within which appeals to the court are to be entered. Even the High Court may make and issue general rules and prescribe forms of regulating the practice and proceedings of such court. Conclusion. There is no enunciated demarcation beyond which each of these organs cannot cross. What is most expected out of each of them is that they consciously realize the unseen boundaries and respect each other's sovereignty. This realization would help in upholding the rights of the citizens and establishing a welfare state. It is important to value the efforts of the framers of our Constitution, who envisaged the nation's future as a harmonious relationship between the pillars of the government. It is not only the duty of the tripartite to realize the same, but also the obligation of the citizens to realize the ultimate sanctity of the Constitution. Thank you.